Good evening and welcome to TV1 Business Bureau, where you can enlighten yourself by an amazing serial entrepreneur, innovative entrepreneur, and update yourself with the trending latest hottest business news. We have heard about social entrepreneurs and many other entrepreneurs. Today we're going to talk to a serial innovative entrepreneur, the owner of the largest e-commerce online shop in Sri Lanka, chairman founder of Kaprupa, Kaprupa Global Shop and Grasshoppers. An amazing personality, a humble leader, of the leading business personalities in Sri Lanka, Dulip Khera. The founder and the chairman of Kaprupa.com. Today we're going to talk to an innovative entrepreneur, Dulip Khera. Hi Dulip.
Hi.
How are you doing?
Very good.
How's everything going on these days?
Well, this is the seasonal time, so best time for e-commerce. So we are very busy. Busy is good. I love being busy. I love waking up for problems. So it's all good.
That's wonderful. And you're always happy to say that you're busy. But a lot of people say they're busy with a very unhappy face. But it's always nice and motivating to see you saying busy with a beautiful smile on your face. What's the reason behind that?
I think it's all about how much you love what you do. Okay. So imagine every problem that you have in the morning is something you look forward to solve. You are naturally happy about it. Honestly speaking, if I wake up in the morning and if somebody tells me, Dulip, there's nothing much wrong today, there's nothing to do, I'll honestly be upset. I want them to tell me, look, you have these problems today, let's solve it. So I love solving problems, so that keeps me happy.
So this is the season and I see a lot of children enjoying and parents enjoying. So now I was looking at some kids getting a lot of toys outside there. So I just want to ask you about your childhood. Now when it comes to childhood, a lot of children are surrounded with a lot of toys and they enjoy watching TV and playing with toys. But what I've heard about you, Dulip, is something totally different. You are surrounded with toys, but more than toys, you're surrounded with a lot of gadgets. And then when it comes to toys, you used to break the toys and refix it and come up with your own innovations. So I'm not going to explain further. I would love to hear about it from you, Dulip.
My childhood. Yes. I think I've been a geek all my life. Okay. So I've gone to Royal College. I never touched a cricket bat. I've never done a single sport in my whole life. Okay. So all I loved to do was innovate and create things from childhood. So when I get a new toy, all I wanted to see was to break it apart, understand what's inside it, and then take, like for example, I would break apart a small toy van and try to take the motor out of it, connect it directly to the batteries and see it spin. And that is more fun to me than actually playing with the van. That's just how I was. I don't know why. It's just, I guess, it's in your DNA. And so from there, I remember wanting to build robots. Right? The robotics was a huge thing in my liking. And then I used to break, 10 different toys and build one big robot. You know, I would take the speaker from one toy, lights from the other one, the batteries and the circuits from the other one. So I remember actually creating a walking, talking robot by the age of about 12. Right, and I guess it's because at that time computers were not that big, right? I'm talking about my childhood when I was about 12 or 13. But the moment I got that first computer, that was the end of my electronics childhood, and then I switched to computers.
I'm sure your mother had a very tough time those days. Well, was she happy about it or was she complaining about it?
Well, both my parents were very supportive of just letting me do what I liked doing. Up to a certain extent, until I got to my A-levels, they got freaked out because I was so behind my studies.
Okay.
So if you want to ask me specifically about that, I can talk about how it evolved after that.
Okay. Now, you were mentioning about studies, and I want to ask you, when it comes to studies, a lot of parents say that studies is very important. But when you ask from the child's side, and when you really look in from the child's side, they say studying is a pain. That's what we used to say. But when it really comes to the real life situation, and when we go to the corporate world, and when we go to the society, only we understand that education is a must and education is really important. I would love to hear about your opinion, because there are a certain set of people who say that education is not a must.
Right.
So I want to hear from you, what is Dulit's explanation or opinion about education?
Oh, education is, I would say it is a must for any entrepreneur. There's this thing called, if you say it properly, ugat vyavasayaka, right? You hear so many stories about few entrepreneurs who had not got education but had made it really big. But you never hear about the entrepreneurs who has failed, who never became entrepreneurs, so failed in life just because they didn't do the education, right? So it's very, very important that you get your education right and then parallelly become an entrepreneur. And thanks to my parents, I did that, because I remember just before my A-levels, 6 months before my A-levels, I came back home and my dad has taken away all my gadgets, all my computers. He has wiped my room. He has pulled my computers from the plugs, boxed it and sent it to my uncle's house. It was like the most saddest moment of my life, I think, at that day, to come into my empty room, because that was my world. But then he told me, you are 6 months for A-levels, do you have any idea how behind you are? Tamasa computer bus connect venne hadanne. That was his exact words.
Wow. Right? Typical parent.
Typical parent. And then I'm so happy he did that. I won't be sitting here today if he did not do that. And then I started studying, and I had four subjects: chemistry, pure maths, applied maths, and physics. I knew how behind I was. I knew I cannot do all four subjects. I removed chemistry entirely. The whole book set I removed out of my table. And I did the other three very well. And I became the seventh in the island. And
wow.
I got 3 A's and 1 F.
So seventh
right?
in the island.
Yes.
Wow, so you are a brainy boy.
No, but the problem is, unless he pulled the plug that day and made me study, I mean, I would have flunked A-levels. I don't know what would have come out of me, actually, at that point. So education is a must. I mean, that got me the scholarship to go to the US. That got me my next steps, right?
So, which year did you travel to US? I know this is a not so good question, because everyone will get to know your age.
Oh, that's fine. I mean, I'm very proudly aging, right? I would never, and only ladies would hide their age.
Yes, right? And one of the youngest
aging
entrepreneurs. So,
I went to the US in around 2000, year 2000. And then from there, I was there for about 6 years, 6 to 7 years. Mm-hmm.
So talking about your university life, when you say that you went to university to US, especially people will think, wow, he's having an amazing time, and especially US, the studies are amazing, and he might be enjoying his life. But if you really look at your life, you have enjoyed your life, but what I've heard is that you used to do four jobs, including delivering pizzas, a librarian, and many more.
That, yeah.
Now, doing four jobs, and especially studying in that particular university and balancing your studies, and on top of all that, becoming homesick and missing all the Sri Lankan food, how did you balance all your work?
Well, all I got was one-way ticket to the US, and the school tuition fees paid by that, by a scholarship. So that was not enough to survive, and my parents were not in a situation to, you know, keep pumping money to me, you know, every month or so, and I didn't want to disturb them. So, and you know, I love being busy, you know that already.
Yes.
So I started one job, just doing pizza delivery at night, and I really loved it. And then I thought, hey, I still can do more. So I ended up doing actually four jobs. I'd become a librarian in the morning, a TA or an assistant to a professor in the evening, and work at a cafeteria in the evening, and go and do pizza delivery, and still did six subjects. And it's just, you know, at that when you are having that kind of I call it the amma, right? That kind of an amma to keep working, you wake up every day morning wanting to do the same thing. You never get tired of it.
We are with a serial entrepreneur, and I can also tell that he's an innovative entrepreneur as well. Hi, once again, Dulit. We were anyway enjoying a nice conversation. So I'll straight away ask you, how did you come up with this idea, Cup Rooker? And when did you come up with this idea? Because, a lot of people come up with thousands of ideas and they sometimes die without even implementing it. And I would like to know when you came up with this idea. And did you implement, or did you start implementing on the same day, or like day after, or 1 year's time? Yeah. Or?
Well, you, as a serial entrepreneur, you have ideas almost every day. Okay. And it's very important to figure out which idea is good, which one you want to really pursue. Otherwise, you will try one idea, next week you get another
keep
idea,
on
keep on changing. So the Cup Rooker idea actually was with me for a long time. I would wake up every morning dreaming about it. You kind of fall in love with the idea. When you fall in love with an idea, you can see it in your eyes. You go to sleep thinking about it. You wake up in the morning thinking about it. That means you are really, really in love with that idea. So Cup Rooker was one of those. So when it started 12 years ago, it was very early and it was very difficult to believe in the idea because the market was not there. So imagine today I'm trying to sell toys. I don't need to create a market, right? It's already, people are wanting toys. But 12 years ago, when you created Cup Rooker, e-commerce was not there, right? So I had to really bet that, you know, this is going to thrive. I had to believe it. You understand what I mean?
Like, yes.
You know, when you...
You need to believe
you
in it.
You have to believe in it and it's not there.
That's
so
true.
You have to believe it's going to work. Right? And those are the kind of ideas that really can take off because there is no competition. It's a new space you are getting into. So
and,
it is,
and you're innovating something.
Yes.
That's amazing. So I want to ask you now, you have come up with your idea. You started loving your idea. Then you started implementing your idea, believing in it. Then, now, lot of entrepreneurs struggle more than the idea, more than implementing. Lot of people struggle thinking, what should I name my business? What should I name my company? Because a lot of people put a lot of time thinking about that.
Right.
Now, your role model, the company is Amazon. Without naming it Singharaja, you named it Cup Rooker. I'm sure there are many reasons behind it. I would love to know a few reasons behind Cup Rooker.
First rule is you don't want to just kind of copy something, right? Just because it's Amazon, I don't want to copy it and call this the Sri Lanka's forest. What I copied or what I looked up was the industry of e-commerce, not Amazon. Amazon is doing a great job, but I was not interested in replicating something. I saw an industry, okay? So to thrive the industry, what I needed was a brand name that gave me the freedom to trade whatever I want, okay? So if you come up with a specific name, you can only do that specific topic. But if you call a generic name like Amazon or Cup Rooker, that gives you the freedom to do whatever I want under it. Okay? Imagine I call my company the cars company, I can only sell cars.
Yes.
Right? I can't sell apples. But when you come up with a name that is generic, then you can sell whatever you want. And also, Cup Rooker is very, if you ask specifically about the name, it's very difficult to misspell Cup Rooker. Okay? You try hard, you cannot misspell Cup Rooker. And it's a short name, it sticks in your mind, it's very sticky. And I was able to get the .com that early on. So all those attributes, you know, matched and there goes the name.
So
and it's very important. Actually, you asked me about a lot of people spend time on picking the name. And you made it kind of sound like it's not important or whether are they wasting time.
Yes.
No, I think it's very, very important to spend a lot of time on the name because that's the brand you are going to try to build for the rest of your life. Right? So it's so damn important you get the name right. Now, all my companies that I've started so far, I spend months on the name. Cup Rooker, Cup Rooker Global Shop, Grasshoppers, all these companies, I spend so much. I mean, I would write down 10 names, show it to so many people, get their feedback, make it 5 names, make it 3 names, and then get that last one. Right? So you spend a lot of time on the name that you're going to give for your beautiful idea.
Parents take a lot of time to name their child because they love them. They love the child so much, they invest a lot of time to name their baby girl or boy. The same way, if you're starting a company, like Dulit said, take a lot of time, think about your company and make sure you name it right, that you can brand it right as well. There's a saying that you need to sleep 8 hours. I want to ask
Says
you.
Who?
The doctors say, but I don't say because I'm not a believer of 8 hours. So, but what I've heard about you is that you don't sleep 8 hours. So I want to know from you how many hours you sleep and how you manage all your time and work.
No, I sleep very little, right? I live with coffee. This is like my fuel. But I think, so this, there's a young age that people can work like maniacs, right? You can't work like that in your childhood, and you can't work like that in your elderlyhood, right? So I think this is my time, right? I don't want to sleep. Right? I will sleep when I have to, when I'm done with, you know, creating my companies, love what I'm doing. Sure, I'll sleep 10 hours a day, right? And there is one point that I'm kind of going to retire myself and believe in the next generation, right? Look, watch the next generation, empower them, watch them like a father to them, right? Then I'll have my sleep. No, this is my time to work hard. So I'm limited. I mean, it's not that that you go crazy and sleep only 2 hours, right? You would someday sleep 8 hours, someday sleep 4 hours. So I kind of balance it. In fact, my wife has a sleeping chart in my room.
Okay.
Because she's so worried that my sleep patterns are so bad. She would mark it and show me, look, yesterday you only did this much. I think this week you need a little bit extra.
covering the sleep hours. So how many hours do you sleep roughly?
On a good day, 5 hours.
There's a saying, success is not a destination but a journey. And you have proved that. You started Kapruka, it became successful, but you did not stop there. You went on to Kapruka Global Shop. And then from there, you started Grasshoppers. I would love to know about the journey.
Well, I guess that's what serial entrepreneurship is about. The moment I have the first company successful, it becomes less challenging. It kind of goes on autopilot, right? Then you want to create the second baby and the third baby. So it's like a family, actually. You know, you keep having babies because you love having babies, right? You want more children. So, but I make sure that I climb only one mountain at a time, okay? And a lot of entrepreneurs get it wrong by trying to climb too many mountains at the same time. So I would climb one mountain at a time. And all these three mountains I've created are connected with each other. They are not diversified. No, I would not go and, you know, start a plantation somewhere and do e-commerce on the side. All three are very interconnected because what I love is e-commerce.
There's a saying that success is not a destination but a journey. Dulit Herat has already proved that. Starting from Kapruka, not stopping there, moved on to Kapruka Global Shop. And then making it a successful business, did not stop there, but moved on to Grasshoppers. And all three simultaneously is happening in an amazing manner. And he is cooking something very big with Amazon. And we're waiting to hear that from him. And today we learned a lot of things. So entrepreneurs, remember to do a pilot for whatever the business you start, and many more things that we learned today